There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Such a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen.
Here comes the rain down on us.
Praise the Lord. How many of y'all actually believe in the promise of God? The promise. Amen. Amen. When we begin to believe in the promise, our thoughts begin to change. Our actions begin to change. The way we react begins to change. The places we go begins to change. To your feet as we go high into the Lord and receive the word of God. See what it is God has for us on this morning. I ask you to receive our pastor.
Privilege and an honor to be in the house of the Lord one more time. This morning, the message is going to be coming from Luke chapter 7, verses 44 through 47. Luke chapter 7, verses 44 through 47. We all been dealing with some things, and I know personally I have, and God been dealing with me and healing and restoring and fixing some things in my life. And there's one thing that we forget to do is to give God the glory and honor that's due Him. A lot of times we complain and we're telling God of what's going wrong and how people are treating us, but sometimes we forget that even Isaiah 54 and 17 says that no weapon that is formed against me shall be able to prosper. But you forget the verse that's before it says that He created the blacksmith that blows the coal that He puts over the fire. So He's as forming the weapon. God has created Him, and sometimes it's for to get you into another purpose or another place in God. So He creates these storms and these tests and these trials and these tribulations. And we're so busy complaining that we forget to look at what God is really doing in our lives and just to say, God, thank you. Because, see, He suffered even more than we did. And all He did was come to show love on this earth. And yet they treated Him badly and mistreated Him. The church both were the worst both. They wanted to kill Him. They crucified Him. But still and all, He only came to show us love. Before we go into the word, let us pray. Luke chapter 7, verses 44 through 47. And it reads, "Then He turned to the woman and said to Simon, 'Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little.'" Title of the message this morning is "I Love Him in My Worship." First of all, we have to know what the word worship means. Worship is worthiness. It's broken down as worth-ship. And it says to give worth to something. What is God worth to you? In our text, we have this woman. And the Bible describes her as a sinful woman. The woman was Mary Magdalene. And in the Bible, it says that she had seven demons cast out of her. We don't know exactly what all of the demons was, but one of them, she was in prostitution. And this woman was forgiven. She came to Jesus hurting. She came to Jesus needing healing. She came to Jesus even mixed up in her sins. And a lot of time we talk to people and people are always telling you, well, I'm going to get myself together first and then I'm going to come to the Lord. But it don't work that way. And a lot of times when they tell me that, I just bust out laughing, even over-exaggerated laughing, because you can't work it out. If you haven't been able to work it out this long, you sure not going to work it out. God says, come unto me, all of you that are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke, because my yoke is easy. Take my burdens, for my burdens are light. So our yoke and the yokes that we carry are heavy, but God said, if you give them to me, I'll give you mine. Mine is easy. So the things that I'm asking you to do, though it may seem hard, and all I'm asking you to do is just obey me. Live right, be righteous, follow my commands, let me order your steps. That's an easy thing to do, because he's saying, I'm opening the doors for you and I'm going to show you what to do. I laid it all out for you. I'm going to help you through every trial and tribulation. If you go through the things that I'm sending you through, I'm going to help you through it. My burdens are light. My yoke is easy. Yet and all, there's still people that still try to figure out things and try to work things out themselves. I know I do it sometimes myself. God, get out the way for just a minute. Let me try to handle it myself, and I mess it all up because I don't feel God is moving fast enough, or he ain't correcting the way I want him to correct it. God, I want you to beat him down right in front of my face, in front of everybody. But God says, I will that none perish. But all come to repentance. So his end result is that regardless of what they're doing, regardless of what the circumstance is, God says, I want everybody to be saved. And if we have that mindset and we say, God, give me your heart. Let me see people through your eyes. Let me love them with your heart. Let me understand them with your mind. Then we'll be able to understand the ways of God, because it says his ways and his thoughts are much higher than ours. We can't even begin to comprehend how God is going to fix a thing. But if you just stand back and let God fix it, he's going to fix it. There was one of the Pharisees that asked Jesus to come in and dine at his house. So as he sat down to eat, now he was in with all the men, and you know how they have these traditional men that we don't want women in our presence. We don't want women to preach. We don't want women to do this. We don't believe in that. We don't believe in this. There's so many disbeliefs or unbelieving and stuff that, well, I need to know, what do you believe in? Give me a list of that. So anyway, they were sitting down in the house and eating, and then it says, behold, look and see, check this out. A woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus had sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, she came with an alabaster box. She came with some precious oil. And when you read another text, it said that Judas was mad because of this oil, because this was some expensive perfume. He said, we could have sold this and got about $300 for this. So she came with this alabaster box with this fragrant oil, and she stood at his feet behind him, and she was weeping. And the reason why she was weeping, because she was so happy because she had just got delivered and been set free. I don't know how many of you have been delivered or set free from some things. I remember when I was bound to alcohol and drugs, I really thought I was doing something, but really I was weighed down every day. Because now I done spent up all of my money, and once I come down from my high, I'm trying to think of how I'm going to replace this money and take care of these bills that I've overlooked because I was so busy trying to satisfy my flesh. And then you're going through some things and getting into relationships with people that you shouldn't be connected to, and all those spirits are bound on you. The next thing you know, you are weighted down, and now you're sitting down, and you, when God comes and he delivers you from that stuff and uplift that stuff, before you know it, you feel set free. So I can imagine how she felt. She must have came in sitting out for that whole day and saying, man, I just don't feel the same. I look down at my hands look new. I looked at my feet and they look new too. I wasn't the same anymore. I looked in the mirror and I saw brightness in the mirror. I looked at myself and I could smile again. So she came when she heard Jesus was in this place, and I got to get to this place. And I don't know how many of you ever heard when you heard a
about a certain church or a certain event that's about to happen, and you know, you say, I know God is going to show up today. I just got to go in there and hear a word from the Lord. Don't you know that's when God is really going to show up? Because you come with a spirit of expecting. See, I'm expecting God to come in and show up. And that's the way I live every time I leave my house. I'm like, I know, God, you're going to show up. I need to hear a word from you today. I need some encouragement on today. So she walked in and she stood at his feet and she began to cry. And with the tears from her eyes, she began to wash his feet with him. And then she took her hair and began to wipe the tears from his feet. And then she anointed his feet with this fragrant oil, meaning that she began to worship him. When we come into the presence of the Lord, it's already understood that he says, well, two or three are gathered together in my name, that he right there in the midst. So when he's in the midst of me, I'm already ready to worship. I'm already ready with my tears. I'm already ready with whatever pressures inside of my heart. That's what that alabaster box is. I'm coming with my hurt. I'm coming with my discouragement. I'm coming with my pains. I'm coming with everything that has disappointed me in my life. I have my alabaster box and I'm going to pour it on his feet. But here comes the church folk. Here comes the haters. Here comes the doubters. Here come those that says, now what you doing in here? What she want? Just last week she was at the club dropping it like it's hot. Now all of a sudden she's standing up trying to get to Jesus. Get back and let her get to Jesus. I remember a pastor came in here preaching one anniversary, and there was some lesbians that came in, and she was like, now it's time out for pastors letting lesbians sit on the pews. Why they don't sit? That's what they supposed to be. They come into the house of the Lord for healing. You come for deliverance. If they can't come to Jesus, then where can they go? The Bible said you shut up the kingdom of heaven. You won't go in yourself, and you won't allow others to go in either. Now when the Pharisees who had invited Jesus saw this woman coming in and saw her worshiping Jesus, then they spoke to him and they said, they were speaking to themselves, saying, now if he was really a prophet, he would have known what type of woman this was that was coming up before him. He would have known who was worshiping him. He would have understood who was worshiping him. He would not have let her even touch him, because this woman is a sinner. My Bible tells me, Jesus said, I didn't come for the righteous. I didn't come for those who are already well. I came for the sinner. I came for those who are sick. Because those who are already well don't need me. And Jesus answered and said to the man, he said to Simon, Simon, I got something to say. He spoke about a certain creditor. He said he had two debtors, two people who owed him money. One owed 500 denarii and the other owed 50. And they had no money to repay him. So he freely said, don't worry about it. You good. Tell me, which one of them loved him more? Of course, the one who owed the most money is going to be more happy, because it's like, man, I owed a whole bunch of money and you told me it was okay. How many of you be okay when you go to the bill collector and you owe $200 or $300 and you only had 50 with you, and they say, well, I'll take the 50. Oh, I'm so excited. I'm so happy. I only have a few $100 to put down on this card. I know you want $3,500, but I'll go in on and take the 200 you got. How many of you going to be so excited? Simon said, I suppose it would be the one who was forgiven for more. And Jesus said, you said that right, brother. You got that right. Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? Said Simon, look, I came into your house and you didn't even give me a drink of water. You saw me thirsty, you saw my tongue hanging out, you saw me cotton mouth, I was all dry on the inside, you saw beads of sweat coming down from me, you saw me up sweat, my clothes were stuck to my body, but still now you didn't even offer me a drink of water. But this woman, she washed my feet with her tears and she wiped them with the hair of her head. When I came in, you didn't even greet me. You didn't even say, good morning, dog. How many of you, boy, I mean people you done stuff for, people that you've been there for, people you want to encourage you, go into their house or you go by them and they pass by you like you don't even exist. Man, I just took a bullet for you. I just laid down my life for you. You can't so much as part your lips to say, hey. So you didn't even give me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You didn't anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my head with fragrant oil. She came sincerely. And there are many church folk who've been in church all of their lives, and they will sit down in church so frozen, so dead, and you'll be praising and worshiping, people falling out all over the place, and they're just sitting down like, move me if you can. But I've been saved, sanctified, and Holy Ghost filled all my life. On Friday night, we went to a revival. And when we came in, there was the lady who was supposed to be one of the mothers of a church, so say, one of the mothers or whatever. When we passed in, I smiled at her. She turned and she said, she said, okay, all right, I guess I'm in the right place. I know I'm at church now. Yes! The woman on the front row with the biggest hat on. Yes! Then afterward, when they got ready for the prayer line, guess who they gonna tell to come and lay hands on me? I said, oh no, you're not. Oh no, you're not. Oh, but you know. Say that this woman came in worshiping, came in praising. You look at the ones that probably been on the street corner all night long, been at the club all night long, been in the drug house all night long, but when they come into the house of the Lord, they have tears flowing, they're waving their hands, they're patting their feet, they're standing up and praising God and singing worship songs, but you can't get the church folk to open their mind and say, thank you, Lord. It's all in the worship. Yeah. And I'm sure Mary probably wanted to say, like the song, you don't know my story. You don't know the things that I've been through. You don't know the pain that I had to endure. My worship is for real. I am worshiping God for real because y'all just don't know the hell that I've been through. You just don't know. I didn't even think I was going to make it through the night, but I'm up and I'm awake. When I was at the revival, of course, I just knew it. I said, they're going to call me up, I already know. And then as the minister began to minister, and I know I didn't come in wearing, because I try not to wear my feelings in my face. I try not to. But he just knew it. And the first thing he did was grab a heart. He said, God wants to heal you. You're hurting. And he said the same thing. He said, there are some people in your life that had to move, and you were trying to hold on to them, but they had to go.
Yes.
But God wants to heal you everywhere you're hurt. And I sat down and I began to weep, and then the next thing he said was, I just want you from now on, just say thank you.
Yes.
Just say thank you. And I never thought about that, and we went through something on yesterday, and I was so hurt and so worried. And I didn't even think to just say, well, God, I already know if I ask for it, it's already done. I already know you got my back. I already know that if I have faith enough to believe that I can have whatever I say. But I still sat down worrying so bad that my head was about to explode. Then before you know, I got a call. Everything is okay.
Come on.
And then I remembered what the man of God said. Just tell God, thank you. I forgot to tell him, thank you. I was They were seeing Jesus coming to town and they began to cry out, Lord, have mercy. The people say, be quiet.
Come on.
But if you only knew what I've been delivered from, if you only knew the hell I've been through, if you only knew my story, if you only knew my pain, you would get down and be worshiping him with me. I pour out everything I have to him because he has forgiven me for so much. He has set me free. God has been in my life and he has fixed some things in my life. So for that, I am thankful. So I pour out everything I have to give to him, to show him the worship, the praise, and what he's worth to me. So I ask you today, what is God worth to you? What has he done in your life? What has he delivered you from? What has he spared your life from? There are some of us that shouldn't even be here today because we were in some situations that we should have died. We should have made it through. We should have lost our minds. But God was there and he kept you. So if you want to go into a place where he is, what would you do when you see him? What would you do when you get in his presence? Would you get down and begin to worship him? I thank you, Lord, for everything you're doing. I thank you for just being God all by yourself. And if you don't deliver me from this, God, I know that you're able. How many of us can just give him a worship? God, I thank you. So you'll turn to your loved one and say, good morning, baby. So can you turn to can you turn to God and say, good morning, God? Thank you, God, for waking me up this morning. Thank you, God, for keeping me all night long. When I get up in the morning, I say, thank you, Lord, that you watched over us while we slept and slumbered. Thank you, God, that you kept us. Thank you, God, that even though things were going on outside, God, you watched over us. I shouldn't have made it. Things shouldn't have been favorable. But God came through because his grace and his mercy followed me all the days of my life. And for that I thank him. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever as long as I have breath in my life. My granddaughter told me on yesterday, Grandma, I don't want you to die. Because if you die, you're going to be in heaven too long, and I'm going to miss you. We don't know what death is. We don't know when our last day will be here on this earth. But just for the life that God has given us and the opportunity and the people that he has placed in our lives, our family, our loved ones, the things that he's allowed us to have, we should be just thankful. He didn't have to do it. Song says tragedies are commonplace. All kinds of diseases, people are slipping away. A lot of us could have been caught up or had some things or some diseases we could not be cured from today. Because we've been in some situations and laid down with dogs and came up with fleas. But God had mercy. A lot of us, our lives have changed around. You look at us right now, there's some people that see me today, I pass right by them and they don't even know who I am. But some of them, I don't want them to know who I am. Because God's grace and mercy changed and transformed us and made us into the image of him. So we should be thankful. 8 months. I didn't show, I just knew I was sick. Went to the hospital. The doctor said, you got so much drugs in your system. So when he said that, I said, I gotta get out of here because I'm going to jail. But when my daughter was born, she had not one trace of drugs in her system. She should have been born a black baby, but she was not. So I felt her coming out, and I was like, oh, Lord, I'm about to have this baby right now. I got to, God help me. But when God fixed all of that. My daughter, they came to get mom. So I go around and I'm like, Quad, and I will go to your outside. Come on outside. So they jumped us, man, and everybody. I'm throwing punches too. I guess I don't know what happened, but the next thing I know, Tracy said, Mama, you're bleeding. Blood dripping all down. And I didn't even know it. Just kept on drinking. Had a P.O. bottle full of crack cocaine. Went to the hospital. 28 staples, 27 stitches in the back of my head. Still got a scar from here to here. I could have died. They said, I've lost so much blood, I'm on the operating table. And I'm like, man, I gotta get out of here. I get up, the doctor say, told my brother, let her get up, she not gonna make it that far. So all I did was got up, next thing you know, I'm ready to take it. But I made it through. It could have been worse. Cause somebody said that the knife was headed for my daughter's heart. But God intervened. So what I'm trying to tell you right now is I got so much to be thankful for. So when you see me praying, I can't get a
to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There is power. Come on. In the name of Jesus.
Come on, you declare it.
There